I hope Ruben said something nice about me. You speak in completely different language than us. If somebody doesn't see me behind these weird lamps, then feel free to sit somewhere else. I have my plan for this lecture, but I think it's no need to be too formal, and if there are some questions, then you can ask them without hesitation, and feel free for open discussion. I don't know if Ruben mentioned, but I studied history. I have a bachelor's degree in history. I don't have a degree in philosophy. My views on Nietzsche are not views of expert, so to say. But I've read Nietzsche for some years now. It was my first serious writer that I was reading, and he's very important for me personally. And from time to time, I again return to his writings and always find something new there. So this is why a lecture about him was a task that I really, really enjoyed. So today I will tell about Nietzsche, his philosophy, and in my view, and not only in my view, the main core of his philosophy, like the title of the lecture, Nietzsche as a pagan philosopher, that there was a certain core of paganism, if you could use this term, in his philosophy, and I will later explain why. Of course, Nietzsche has become part of pop culture, in a sense, and that's why his ideas and quotes are used widely and usually out of context, unfortunately, and this creates some misunderstandings about him. His main concepts, many of them you know, is perspectivism instead of reason. He rejected the whole paradigm of enlightenment, of the reason as a supreme tool for man. His master-slave morality concept, death of God, which is most widely used, I guess. Will to power, also Übermensch or Overman, Superman, depends how you translate it, and eternal return, which is most I would say abstract and most easily to misunderstood term. But I'm not saying that I'm the last instance of truth in these things. Why Nietzsche was important for nationalists and for ethno-nationalists. He was, in a sense, part of a movement, or not even a part, but he started the movement in Europe. In this middle 19th century, when he appeared, he stood beside people like Darwin and maybe Schopenhauer. He continued his work, but those people who came after him were something else, and this movement could be called in many names. I prefer term vitalism or vitalism, which meant that if Enlightenment put the main emphasis on reason, then Nietzsche and his followers, if you can, you can say that one can be a follower of Nietzsche, they put emphasis on life, and this is a completely different way to look at philosophy of truth, of politics. And this reaction against reason and enlightenment inspired early 20th century nationalism, futurism, also at least some of the fascistic movements, but also anarchist movements, some left-wing movements, and especially in 1920s and 1930s. In this interwar period, this revolt against reason and foundations of modern Europe was most active, and the whole intellectual elite of West was part of this at that time. Of course, after Second World War with National Socialism, he was for several decades maybe not discredited, but it wasn't that popular to talk about Nietzsche. Like, it wasn't popular to talk about Spengler or any of these Germans who were quite with interesting ideas. But in 1960s, again, leftists used his ideas in the context of postmodernism and existentialism. So, was he right-wing or left-wing? It's an open question. I would say he was beyond these terms, like he was beyond good and evil. And it depends on how you define right-wing. He wasn't conservative in traditional sense. He wasn't nationalist, like ethno-nationalist. He was certainly right-wing, if you use this term, as he was a person who was for hierarchy, for inequality of people. He was for authentic aristocracy, not based on blood, but based on, like he said, will to power. And he was strongly against French Revolution and everything that came out of it. So, in this sense, he was clearly right wing. But he was something on his own. Of course, both right wing and left wing movements have used his concepts for their political goals. Like in First World War, German soldiers had in mass printed his quotes and books that they took to front line. But also some left wing movements use some of his concepts. I would say that left wing uses mostly them out of context, because I will tell later about the idea of nihilism and that of God, and how it stands in his like wider philosophy. It is also easy to use his ideas out of context, because of he himself was a very contradictory thinker. He wasn't systematic. He rejected rationality, so his writings were in a completely different style. It was more based on poetry, on symbols. It has many layers. For each idea, there is some contradictory idea in his writings. And if you just take like one sentence or one quote and put it in a picture and share it on Facebook, it doesn't mean that this is quite what Nietzsche meant. And also, he himself changed with time his ideas and concepts. His philosophy has I distinguish three stages, but maybe there are more. First stage, and all these stages were influenced by very personal reasons, mainly his friendship and later end of the friendship with Richard Wagner. First stage was with his first main work, Birth of Tragedy, where he put more emphasis on art, on aesthetics, as the main way to judge life itself. Life is justificated by art, by artwork, which of course was liked very much by Richard Wagner, and he used Nietzsche to support his art, and other way around. Second part of his ideas is when he separated with Wagner, and Wagner was very weak philosopher, and Nietzsche was a very weak musician, but they, if they wouldn't have separated, I think actually they really were part of one big project was that was transvaluation of values of the Europe. In this second part, he put more emphasis on concepts like will to power. He also in some sense rejected the meaning of art as just another illusion like religion. But also in this stage there were some, I would say, negative aspects of his philosophy that are clearly very personal, like he started to despise Germans as a nation. He even fictionalized his biography. He started to claim that he has Polish ancestry, which most probably he didn't have. And later part of his career is where you can sense his mental breakdown coming up, and I'm not going to speculate why that happened. There are many theories, but like in one of his later works, Ecce Homo, you can sense that he's becoming more and more separated from reality. There are such titles in this work like Why I Am So Wise, Why I Write Such a Good Books, Why I Am Destiny. In later, in his mental illness, when he wrote letters for Kaiser, this hyperbolic style is becoming even more evident. He started to exaggerate many things about himself, about humanity. He also tended to in his quest to transvaluate values, he also sometimes he became very materialistic. He tried to overcome these terms, but sometimes he's writing about like how the food that you eat is more important than any values or morality, and things like this. So he was certainly not without faults. He's not like only truth, and you have to be critical about Nietzsche himself. Nevertheless, I believe that he's one of the most important thinkers in Western history, if not the most important in last couple of centuries, because I think in this one person there are these crossroads of Western civilization of last 1,000 or 2,000 years, and he reflected about this. He saw what was happening, where we are going, and he tried to solve this riddle. And his main task was this re-evaluation of values. He saw that spiritually Europe is changing. He sensed it way before many others sensed it, and he tried to find a solution for this. And he predicted that there will be many crises because of this problem of nihilism, and his whole life work was to overcome this nihilism, which is the main Maybe for the roof. Okay, thank you. So, about nihilism, and this is the main difference where I think left-wing Nietzsche supporters and readers and right-wing stand. For Nietzsche, nihilism was not end in itself. For him, it was these crossroads. And his opposition to Christianity and morality and all these things was because of his quest to overcome this nihilism. Why he was against Christianity and in what way he was against Christianity? For him, problem with Christianity was not problem about truth, about rationality. This discussion whether biblical stories are historical or not, these were very old at that time. For him, problem with Christianity was that Christianity and transcendental nature of Christianity, that God and all the higher values are something somewhere beyond life. This for him was denial of value of life here and now, and this led to this nihilism where nothing is truth and nothing has any value. He traced it to the beginnings of Christianity. His main motivation was not therefore search for truth or historical truth or to prove that God is not possible because of some material reasons or something like that. For him it was that Christianity was opposed to further development of man as a spiritual being. He also did not kill God, he simply observed that he is dead. And he wrote that what are churches now if not tombs and monuments to the God. Therefore, he simply saw that in 19th century Europe, Christianity was only form without content, and it existed only with inertia. It didn't have the force that it once had. If thinkers before him saw that Christianity had problem with rational arguments, then Nietzsche's problem was that Christianity and its morality was a problem for European men. And for him, this Christian religion is problem because it is opposed to spirituality, and this is his, I would say, his paganism. Although he didn't define it as paganism, and he wasn't conscious of it, but if I'm not mistaken, but I think he is the first philosopher in Europe at that time that tried to create a thinking system, if you can say, system that was completely opposed to all the Christian philosophy and everything that came out of it. And for him, out of Christianity came also socialism, liberalism, democracy, everything that was connected with the role of mob, of quality, of equality over quality. This all was for him part of the same problem. One can even trace this problem of Christianity to Greeks. He was, for example, philosophically against Socrates and his emphasis on truth. Maybe even Plato, his idealism, that main value of life is somewhere beyond, not in the life itself. And for him, this belief in unreachable God, in these big values that are somewhere beyond, not here and now, this was the cause of this nihilism. Therefore, what's the solution? For him, solution is that these values have to be completely redefined, and real values have to be here in this life and have to be reachable. This is the main reason why he came up with concept of Superman or Overman, which I will tell later. About this Christianity, for him Christian morality was invented by slaves, by weak men against the strong. He was very sympathetic to ancient Greece, ancient Rome, and he saw these aristocratic values of ancient civilizations as far superior than those of Christianity. For him, Christianity was a revolt of the slaves in the form of it was for him the first like transvaluation of values. If before Christianity beautiful was the same as good, or strong was the same as good, and what was weak was bad, then Christianity turned these values around, and the powerful were the bad, and the weak and slaves were the good ones. So he saw this problem of Christianity also continued in later history. He defined it as a war between Judea and Rome, and he saw it also repeating in Reformation, in French Revolution, that for him were these representatives of Judea, and opposed to that was Rome, it was Renaissance, it was Napoleon. Who knows what he would have to say about 20th century. He was not against Christ as a prophet. For him, he separated the message of Christ with Christianity. For him, Christ was a great man who had his practice, not a doctrine, but practice and he taught through his life, and he saw in Christ mainly opposition towards the church. At Christ's time, it was opposition to Judaism, and he saw that his disciples distorted his message and instead created a new church. And if for him Christ offered kingdom in man himself, then his disciples like Paul offered kingdom somewhere beyond, and this he saw as a problem. And this tendency to put God and values somewhere beyond, it's as Nietzsche also saw it, it's anti-pagan. Paganism does not separate God and spirituality with life here and now, with nature and with men. But in Eastern religions there is this tendency to separate. Like in Islam, where it's forbidden to portray images of God. And this tendency is also in Christianity. And in paganism, for example, beauty is expression of something divine. In Eastern religions, it's other way around. You separate these things. So he saw that Christianity in 19th century was basically over as a morality and as a spiritual teaching, and for him this was a phase where these values should be transvaluated, and he defined himself as an anti-nihilist nihilist, which means that he saw nihilism as a tool, as a way to destroy, like he said, we must destroy morality to liberate life, and the second part is his goal, to liberate life. And he saw that if it's not achieved, if we stay to this phase of nihilism, then it's even bigger problem. If there are no new goals and European man is stays in this second phase of nihilism, then this would lead not to overman but to last man, which is another concept of him, which we hear a bit less about. And if we observe our era and where we live, then we can see that his prediction actually came to truth. He predicted that with pure rationality, with this materialistic solution to problem of religion, we will stay in the second nihilism. That's why also he wanted to overcome reason, and he saw that the dogma of this superiority of reason that came with Enlightenment was main obstacle for this spiritual renaissance of Europe. And like I said, liberalism, socialism, and rationalism for him was just secular versions and continuity of Christianity. He defined, like, for example, socialism as tyranny of the least and the dumbest. For him, socialism is animalization of men, reduced to the rank of dwarfs, all having the same rights and the same needs, and liberalism as a narrow, selfish individualism, but with the atomization of society, without any vision and any higher goal. He was for exceptional men, for geniuses, for strong men, and in liberalism and in socialism it was impossible to find these great men. They were opposed to it. His conception of freedom is quite different from that of liberalism. Liberalism is freedom from something, negative freedom. For Nietzsche, as he clearly defines it in his most famous work, Das Spruch Zarathustra, it is not important what you are free from, but what you are free for. Why are you free? What will you use your abilities and your freedom to achieve? In German language there is a different word, Freiheit, which means this freedom for, not like English word liberty, which is freedom from something. And for him, the goal of self-overcoming and self-perfection, these were very important to achieve his goal. And what is his goal? I would say that his main goal, and all other concepts are just around his goal, is this overman or Übermensch. For him, man is not a goal in itself. If in liberalism, goal is to protect man as he has sacred rights and his value in itself, for him, man is just a tool, just a transitionary phase. Man, like he wrote, is a rope between animal and overman. And the idea of Superman also, for him, solves the problem with religion and with God. Because if a Christian God was somewhere beyond, then overman is goal that is reachable in this life. It is both individual goal and it is also a goal for mankind. And this is the basis of his new philosophy, which was life-affirming philosophy, which was philosophy beyond good and evil. I would say this is a clear pagan philosophy, and he tried to achieve this new philosophy with his style. For example, his symbolic language, his style of many layers and meanings. It's also beyond good and evil, and it's also beyond spiritual and materialistic. He certainly put more emphasis on his style, and he believed that it's important how you write than, for example, facts or truths. They are secondary. And his Superman was part of like bigger project for a new nobility. Like I said, he was against socialism and liberalism. He was also against 19th century nationalism. For him, the goal was a new nobility, and that would be based not on titles, not on ancestry, but on this superiority of soul, of spirituality. His political writings are very, very abstract, and he was writing about what he saw very far future, and therefore his writings about politics are difficult to take and put in practice. He wrote about great politics, like he defined it. He was thinking about international level. He was very right in predicting that next wars and struggles will be about possession of the whole planet, not about small territories. He was for some kind of universalism. He distinguished more between superior men and masses than between nations. Therefore, he's not, like I said, he's not nationalist in a traditional sense. But his universalism was not based on materialism or ideas about peace. Quite contrary. And in this new vision about world, there was element of spirituality, which is often forgotten. He was a spiritual man, but in a different sense than in Christianity. He was writing that maybe God is not dead, but he's only shedding his skin, that he's shaking off the morality, he from time to time wrote about new spirituality, about coming God. In his poems, he wrote about unknown God that he was speaking with. So he was even maybe more spiritual than most of the priests that he criticized. So what was the new God for him? He referred often to Dionysus, which was a Greek god of wine and ecstasy, but he didn't define it like a new god or a new basis for some religion. He used Dionysus as a symbol because it was a god that was celebrating life. It was a dancing god. It was god that it was god of unity of man and nature. It was god of vitality and creativity. And this, of course, was the same with his philosophy. Therefore, Dionysus was a good symbol for him. He was writing about, like I said, this unknown God, and in his poems he mentioned, for example, Chaser of Clouds, Hunter God, Raging Windstorm, that psychologist Carl Jung, in his writings, he saw that Nietzsche was simply referring to Germanic god of Wotan. For Jung, Wotan was a god that was coming back after this death of Christian god. He also saw that Wotanism was basis of National Socialism, and Nietzsche was the one who predicted it in 19th century. That's an interesting theory, of course. His concept of will to power, which is also closely connected to the concept of overman, also usually it's misunderstood. Will to power was part of his philosophy of life. It was meant to reject both materialism, which he saw as a problem, but both transcendentalism of Christianity, that values are somewhere beyond. Will to power means that you accept life, you accept contradictions of life, tragedies, you love, you accept the fate, amor fati. For him, the whole universe is will to power. It is universe is not clockwork like Enlightenment thinkers used to think. For him, universe is more like force. It's more like energy, and man is a creator that uses this energy and this force. And for him, this is the only truth and only thing that matters. How you accept this universe and what do you create out of it. For him, life is a struggle, and mainly it's a spiritual struggle. He was not Darwinist in materialistic sense, but for him this struggle aspect was very important. But he saw this main struggle happening between elites, between spiritual elites, and he despised mass culture and masses, and for him this was more like battleground. The real struggle was happening between these spiritual gigants. His philosophy of life could be seen as restoration of pagan values in a modern context. I don't think he really believed in paganism like a historical truth, and phenomena, but he certainly tried to find the root cause of modern problems, and he found them in dualism, in Eastern, Middle Eastern religions, in Christianity. And for him, this philosophy of life was more useful in the coming era of where men will have to fight for domination of planet, where men will have new technologies, for him the old morality was just not suitable for that. He tried to correct this dualism, that there is good, there is evil, there is material and there is spiritual. In his, for example, in his most famous work, Das Spoke Zarathustra, and he used Zarathustra, which was historical ancient Persian prophet, because Zarathustra, historical figure, was first one who introduced dualism in religion. Before that, there was no such concept. But Zarathustra came, and his main concept was that world is divided into the forces of good and light, and forces of darkness. And man, as a social being, has to participate in the struggle between light and dark. In Zarathustra's teachings, this force of good was, or Ahura Mazda, was a lot stronger than the forces of evil. But later it evolved and merged with Christianity, where it was other way around. Man is sinful because of original sin, and he is bad by his nature, therefore there needs to be a redemption. And the teachings of Zarathustra had a very big impact on Greek philosophy, on Christianity, on ancient Rome, and what Nietzsche did, he took this historical personality of Zarathustra, and he used him as his alter ego or his character in his work. And his Zarathustra did the opposite. He denied this dualism. He returned to more pagan values, more natural values. And for him, like his famous quote for Nietzsche, there are no facts, there are only interpretations. And another quote that I enjoy myself, for what do the trees in the jungle fight with each other? Do they fight for happiness? No, they fight for power. And he didn't see any morality in that. And he distinguished, of course, morality in certain parts of society. As he believed that people are not equal, he saw that some morality can be good for some classes of people, but for higher men, supreme good and supreme evil is the same. And this is his holistic approach. For him, on higher levels, both good and evil is the same, and material and spiritual is the same. Also, a famous quote, what is good? Everything that increases power, and what is bad? Everything that makes weak. And with this, he totally denies the whole paradigm of Christianity, and also Enlightenment. What he was against, like I said, he was against materialistic atheism, and usually he's widely quoted as an atheist, but his atheism was spiritual atheism. It was also he was also against this second nihilism, and he certainly was against egalitarian and decadent modernity. He despised the values of modern society like comfort, safety. For him, this made human into basically animal, and it was even worse than Christian morality. He was not, as it is widely understood, a philosopher of cruelty and barbarity, although he was very radical in his expressions and his concepts, and like he said, he was not a man, he was a dynamite. He was for cruelty mainly against oneself, and cruelty in a philosophical sense. He was very compassionate towards men, but he was when the question became about philosophy and concepts of philosophy and search for truth, he was very radical and one could say even cruel. And he enjoyed Roman Stoic philosophers, and he saw in these rude and in a way barbaric men a philosophical example. Therefore, also Nietzsche is sometimes used as like philosopher of social Darwinism and very narrow fight for power. He was, like I said in the beginning, he was a contradictory philosopher, and you can find many opposite things in his teachings. So this was the main things that I wanted to tell you about. In conclusion, my main conclusion is that Nietzsche was a philosopher that tried to solve the problem of modernity. He tried to create basis for a new era, for a new maybe even civilization, by totally rejecting Christianity, morality of Christianity, and all the political systems that came out of Christianity. He was not so much postmodern philosopher as a philosopher that saw the problem in postmodernity. He tried to solve it with his concepts of overman, of will to power. What came out of it, I would say his main project failed, at least in 20th century, because what he feared the most, animalization of men, welfare state, secularized version of Christianity, all this came to be true after Second World War, especially with welfare state, with new left movements. Although churches are empty, even more than in 19th century, this spirit of Judeo-Christianity that he was against, of materialism, is stronger alive than ever before. So I think in future, whoever will try to solve problem of our age, of postmodernity, he eventually will return to ideas of Nietzsche, and he will search what was good in it, where it went wrong, and how it could be used in our age. So thank you, that's it. So if